carrying 7 Marines and 4 soldiers. Our thoughts are with the families and our prayers as well as the search and rescue efforts are underway. This past year has been one of many challenges and successes for our armed forces and the U.S. Army in particular. Men and women in uniform and their families are performing remarkably well, and our nation owes them a debt of gratitude for their service. The fiscal year 2016 budget request proposes a number of significant changes and important budgetary issues for the Army that will receive our careful attention. We look forward to working with you during this year's appropriations process to ensure the support of needs of the Department of the Army and its important role in protecting our national security interests. This subcommittee also recognizes the uncertainty of the current fiscal environment and the impact it has on the Army. If the Department of Defense has to live with the Statutory Budget Control Act caps in fiscal year 2016, the Army has already indicated that its ability to fulfill national security requirements and meet obligations under the current defense strategy would be put at significant risk. We appreciate the complexity of the fiscal year 2016 budget and look forward to your comments on the impact of sequestration on Department of Army operations, readiness, and modernization efforts. We appreciate and commend you for your distinguished service to our nation, as well as the dedication and sacrifices by all the men and women of the U.S. Army. Your full statements have been received. We appreciate that, and they will be printed in the record. We're pleased to thank the distinguished chairman of the committee and the distinguished senator from Illinois, Mr. Durbin, and we recognize him now for any opening remarks he would like to make.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. In the Durbin. Interest of time, I'm going to ask my opening statement be made part of the record. I had the opportunity to sit down with General Odierno and Secretary McHugh and their staff yesterday and go through a lot of specific items in detail, and I'll save some questions and turn it back to you, Mr. Chairman, to proceed.
Thank you very much. Senator of the Day Award goes to our distinguished friend. Senator Shelby,
I will forego opening statement. I look forward to the testimony and the questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Leahy?
I'll put my statement on the record, and I do mention the terrible tragedy that happened yesterday. As a father of a Marine, I can only imagine how those families feel, and the Army, too.
Thank you. The distinguished senator from Kansas. Thank you. Senator from Missouri, in opening comments.
Well, thank you, Chairman, for holding this hearing, and I want to join my colleagues in expressing our commitment to the families and all those who serve and the unfortunate loss of people in training, and certainly pleased to have Secretary McHugh and General Odierno here today with us.
Thank you, Senator. General, you may proceed. Or is this the secretary? Sorry about my glasses.
I'm happy to stand behind the chief. Well, before I begin, Mr. Chairman, if I may, with your indulgence, I want to thank you and all the committee members for your very gracious comments about the training tragedy overnight and the specter of loss to families. We tend to, I think, understandably think of danger in military service in those times when our military men and women are forward deployed and in kinetic environments. And as I said, that's natural. But what happened last night, I think, underscores the very real circumstances that men and women who put that uniform on face each and every day. And we are enormously in their debt. And in this case, as you and your members have noted, our thoughts and prayers are with the families, and as an Army family, we will stand together. So thank you for your comments. It is amazing how much can change in a year. Over the last 12 months, we've seen the geopolitical landscape morph really at an astonishing pace, from renewed aggression by Russia and increased threats from North Korea to gains by radical terrorists in Iraq, Syria, and Yemen, not to mention the fight against Ebola. The demand for your Army to tackle contingencies around the world has grown at an alarming rate. Far from being foreseeable, our requirements have been more unexpected, our enemies more unpredictable, and our ability to handle multiple simultaneous operations more uncertain. And yet, with such volatility and instability around the world, America's Army is faced yet again with an enemy here at home, the return of sequestration, unprepared units, unmaintained equipment, untrained soldiers. Ladies and gentlemen, our Army, your Army, faces a dark and dangerous future unless this Congress acts now to end these ill-conceived and inflexible budget cuts. Moreover, and I want to be clear here, every installation, every component, and nearly every program will feel the brunt of these cuts. Under sequestration by 2019, we'll reduce our end strength to unconscionable levels, likely losing another six BCTs and potentially a division headquarters, not to mention the impacts to associated enablers, contracts, facilities, and civilian personnel. It is our shared responsibility to jealously preserve the gains in readiness, modernization, and training that we've achieved through your critically important support. And in that regard, let me share with you some of the accomplishments of America's Army this past year. As Russian-backed forces rolled into Ukraine and ex-Crimea and threatened regional stability, our soldiers rapidly deployed to Eastern Europe in a demonstration of U.S. commitment and resolve. From Latvia and Lithuania to Poland and Estonia, soldiers from the 173rd Airborne and the 1st Cavalry showed the world that America would stand with our NATO allies and respond to unbridled aggression. In West Africa, as thousands suffered from the scourge of Ebola, your Army acted. Elements of several units led by the 101st Airborne provided command and control equipment and expertise to support efforts to stop this deadly and destabilizing disease. In response to rapid gains by ISIL, your soldiers quickly returned to Iraq to advise and assist security forces in turning the tide on this barbaric group of radical terrorists. In the Pacific, thousands of soldiers and civilians supported operations to strengthen our partnerships and increase our substantial presence. Today, the headquarters of 9 active Army and 2 Guard divisions are committed to combatant commands, and some, as you noted, Mr. Chairman, 144,000 soldiers are deployed, forward stationed, or committed, including, as you noted, 19,000 mobilized reservists. Moreover, we've done all this while continuing to transform our formations, making them leaner, more agile, and far more lethal. As all of you know so well, such extraordinary success comes at a price, for in the end, the young lieutenant leading his or her platoon on the battlefield, the sergeants training and mentoring their soldiers, the invaluable civilian workforce laboring countless hours to support them, and the young family waiting patiently at home are all human. The stress of war, multiple deployments, and unpredictable requirements doesn't change in the face of indiscriminate funding cuts. Through it all, we have and we will remain committed to supporting the needs of our warriors, from programs to increase resilience and improve behavioral health to the prevention of sexual assault and protection of victims from retaliation. We'll keep faith with our soldiers. But rest assured, the return of sequestration will directly impact critical installation and family programs Army-wide. Members, simply put, we need the President's budget. Our $126.5 billion request is some $6 billion over the potential sequester level and is specifically designed to preserve our modest gains in readiness over the last year and take care of your soldiers. And if approved, we'll invest $3.4 billion above the fiscal year 15 funding levels in training, sustainment, and installation programs that directly support combat readiness, and $2.6 billion in research, development, and acquisition to equip soldiers, protect key parts of the industrial base, and support new innovations. Moreover, this request seeks vital reforms to compensation and force structure that will ensure the funding needed to support near-term readiness and help place the Army on a predictable path to balance, from modest pays changes to pay and allowances to our aviation restructuring initiative are reforms above necessary and prudent to sustain the readiness of our forces and move the Army toward eventual balance. I cannot emphasize enough how these critical reforms and funds are necessary to ensuring that your Army has sufficiently trained and ready soldiers to protect our nation. Ladies and gentlemen of the committee, this is a historic moment. We need to stop talking and start acting. We need wisdom, not words. We need results, not rhetoric. And as I said last year, we need predictability, not politics. As we face extreme instability around the world, we must have certainty here at home. Your soldiers, and I know you agree, deserve no less. We must have an end to sequestration this year, and we must have this budget. In closing, on behalf of the nearly 1.3 million men and women of America's Army, Active Guard, Reserve, and civilian, thank you, each of you, for your continued oversight, partnership, leadership, and support. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary. General Odierno, you would like to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman, Vice Chairman Durbin. I also want to send my prayers to the families of our soldiers and Marines that were lost today. I believe this is a reminder of the sacrifices and commitment that so many of our young men and women are providing every single day to our country, and it's important for us to ensure they are resourced properly. Chairman, today the international security environment continues to be challenged by transnational extremist organizations, as well as by the aggressive actions of several nation states. We face the ruthless behavior of ISIL in Iraq and Syria and persistent threats in Yemen and Libya and in other parts of North and Central Africa. Russian aggression pressures the resolve of both the European Union and NATO, while in the Pacific, China and North Korea alarm our allies and concern our regional interests. We also continue to have ever-evolving threats to our homeland. This is not the time to be divesting of our military capabilities and capacities. But over the last 3 years, we have done just that, decreasing the active component and strength by 80,000, and our National Guard and Reserves by 18,000. We have deactivated 13 active duty brigade combat teams, and we are in the process of eliminating 3 active component combat aviation brigades. We are reducing the total aviation force by 800 aircraft, with almost 700 coming out of the active component. We have slashed our investments in modernization by 25%. We've purged our most needed infantry fighting vehicle modernization and scout helicopter developmental programs. The unrelenting budget impasse has also compelled us to degrade readiness to historically low levels. Today, only 33% of our brigades are ready, when our sustained readiness rate should be closer to 70%. The compromises we have made to modernization and readiness, combined with reductions to our force size and capabilities, translates into strategic risk. We are unable to generate residual readiness to respond to unknown contingencies or to reinforce ongoing operations. We have fewer soldiers, the majority of whom are in units that are not ready, and they are manning aging equipment at a time when a demand for Army forces is much higher than anticipated. The President's fiscal year 16 budget submission recognizes these challenges, but even the President's budget represents the bare minimum needed for us to carry out our missions and execute and meet the requirements of our defense strategy. In order for this budget to work, all of our proposed reforms in pay and compensation must be approved. All of our force structure reforms must be supported to include the Aviation Restructure Initiative. And we must be allowed to eliminate $500 million per year of excess infrastructure capacity that is currently in the Army. We can undertake the proposed reforms or we can accept increased risk. If these reforms and force structure reductions are not approved, this equates to a potential $12 billion shortfall in our budget, comprised of $6 billion in reforms and $6 billion in costs that are masked in OCO funding that must ultimately transfer into our base budget. If BCA caps come back, I want to emphasize again that it would render us unable to meet the defense strategy. Sequestration would compel us to reduce even further the Army end strength, forcing out another 70,000 over the next 5 years from the active component, 35,000 from the National Guard, and 10,000 from the Army Reserves. We would cut out 10 to 12 additional combat brigades. Modernization would come to a standstill. Training would go unfunded, and readiness rates, both unit and individual, would fall to very low levels. Anything below the President's budget compromises our strategic flexibility. It inadequately funds our readiness. It further degrades an already underfunded modernization program. It impacts our ability to conduct simultaneous operations and shape regional security environments. It puts into question our capacity to deter and compel multiple adversaries. But even as the Army confronts a fragile budget and looming BCA caps, we do continue to seek efficiencies while adapting to an unstable world. We've taken advantage of a wartime reset program to reduce depot maintenance by $3.2 billion. We are reducing our reliance on contract logistics support, which will result in nearly $2 billion in cost savings. We've identified and are avoiding costs in excess of $12 billion through our aviation restructure initiative. We've eliminated 12,000 positions by reducing all two-star and above headquarters by 25%. We have reorganized our brigade combat teams, eliminating overhead and maximizing our combat capacity. And we continue to achieve individual and collective training efficiency as we move forward. Our sexual harassment and sexual assault prevention remains our top priority. While recent reports are clear that we have made some initial progress in sexual harassment and assault prevention, we still have much work to do. Our men and women deserve to be treated with dignity and respect and should expect a work environment that is free of harassment, assault, and retribution. A culture of inclusion and of mutual and shared trust is essential. Chairman, I continue to be inspired by the unparalleled experience and professional of the men and women of the United States Army. They demonstrate unwavering dedication and commitment to the mission, to the Army, and to our nation. We have units engaged in Afghanistan, Iraq, Jordan, Kosovo, and across the African continent. We have rotational forces in Europe, Kuwait, and throughout the Pacific, to include Korea. We owe it to them to ensure they have the right equipment, the best training, and the appropriate family programs, health care, and compensation packages commensurate with their sacrifices. The decisions we make today and in the near future will impact our soldiers, our Army, and our nation for the next 10 years. The burden of miscalculation and underinvestment will directly fall on the shoulders of our men and women who we will ask to defend this nation. We simply cannot allow this to happen. I look forward to working with you to solve these difficult problems, and I look forward to your questions. Thank you very much, Chairman.
Thank you, General. We appreciate your comments, and I'm going to yield to other senators in order of the position on the committee and attendance to the hearing. And with that, I'm going to yield to the distinguished senator from Illinois, Mr. Durbin.
Thank you, Senator Cochran. I have two questions. I'll pose both of them. Each of you can decide who will answer. The first question is this. Sequestration is an awful alternative, and it is not only harmful when it comes to our national defense, it has equally onerous impact on our non-defense spending as well. So I hope we don't lapse or fall into this mindless strategy of following sequestration. I'm glad the President's budget did not, and we should not. I hope we have the leadership to overcome it. Speaking of saving money, I've asked questions for many years around here, Simpson-Bowles Commission and other places, of the Department of Defense. Tell me about the contractors who are working for you. How many people are working as contractors, and what do they cost, and how many of them are being reevaluated or reduced? Turns out most of the professional estimates say that a contractor employee costs almost three times as much as a civilian employee for the Department of Defense. The reports from the GAO suggest that the data coming out of the Department of Defense in general, and I'm not specifying the Army, Mr. Secretary, but in general are not very specific in terms of keeping an eye on the costs there and reducing those costs where necessary. So I'd like you to address what you're doing when it comes to contractors. The second area is more specific, and it's a result of my sitting on a lot of airplanes, reading a lot of magazines, and in this case, reading Atlantic magazine and an article written by Robert Scales. And it was entitled Gun Trouble, and I'll summarize it with this heading. He says, the rifle that today's infantry uses has little changed since the 1960s, and it's badly flawed. Military lives depend on these cheap composites of metal and plastic, so why can't the richest country in the world give its soldiers better ones? So I'd like to ask you to address both of those questions, please.
Well, if I may, Senator, I'll start on the contractor issue. And the data points that you referenced, I think we all generally agree with. As to a unit-for-unit cost, and we're doing everything we can to respond to that reality and to save money by reducing contractor reliance. I would tell you, frankly, and I can't speak for the other services, the Army finds contractors in the right time and place is absolutely essential. What they do bring to the table is a necessary expertise, hopefully within a not a prolonged state of time, the ability to bring them on and offboard them much more efficiently than we can a full-time civilian equivalent within the Army. So we will be using them, but to your larger question, we measure contractors and full-time equivalents, FTEs. And over the last several years, we've reduced and insourced contractor positions by more than 10,000. So that's a straight reduction. Our contracting utilization, in no small measure, because we're coming down in Afghanistan in numbers, but that's come down by nearly 13%. There's about 5,000 Army contractors left in Afghanistan at this moment. So as part of our restructure initiative, and the chief mentioned what we're doing at headquarters and up levels and taking 25% of the administrative staff, is trying to ensure that where we do use contractors, it's justifiable, both in terms of the mission, but in terms of dollars. Certainly the chief could add some more comments if he choose to on contractor logistics support, which, as he mentioned, we're saving significant money there as well.
Chairman, two comments. We're absolutely aware of this issue of contractors, and what's important is over the last 10 or 12 years, we became more reliant on contractors as we were burdened by two wars at the same time. So we're very conscious of the problem. There's two things that I would suggest we are doing specifically. One is contractor logistics support. We took much of the work out of the hands of our soldiers and put it in the hands of contractors in order to meet the increased demand. We are in the process of significantly reducing that. We have saved $2 billion already in contractor costs by training our soldiers and giving them back the expertise that is necessary to sustain our equipment. And I expect that will double in the next several years as we continue to transition these responsibilities back to our soldiers, who I want to be experts in sustaining our equipment. Some of that had to do with the purchase of new systems as we were still at war. The second part is at our installations. We have over-relied on contractors to do tasks at our installations that I believe can be done in many different ways, to include using soldiers, not because I think in some cases our soldiers, it's part of their training in order to be used in some areas. For example, guarding our installations. For us, they do that while they're deployed. It's an important task. It's a leadership task. And so we can reduce contractor costs by using our soldiers to do some of these tasks, which we think are military related. And so we are in the process of reviewing all of that. We still have to take a look at where we have some contractors that are doing some things that I believe should be done either by Department of the Army civilians or by uniformed military, and we are continuing to look at that. So we understand and are working very hard to continue to work those efficiencies. On our rifle, I would disagree with the comment that we do not have a good weapon system. We have made 96 modifications to our rifle over the last 10 or 12 years. We have done that by lightening the system, by giving it better sights, by giving it better ammunition, by continuing to make it ease of use more reliable. And I'm very confident in the system that we have now. And I believe it still is performing extremely well, whether it be in Afghanistan, whether it was in Iraq, or anywhere where we use it around the world.
If you have not seen this article in Atlantic, I wish you'd take a look at it and comment in separate.
Okay. Thank you.
Senator Shelby.
Thank you. General Odierno, on November the 7th, 2014, President Obama authorized a further 1,500 troops in addition to the 3,100 American troops already deployed to Iraq, as my understanding. It's also my understanding that these troops have not been called up for deployment yet. Given President Obama's recent request to Congress for an authorization for the use of military force, what role do you see, General, American ground forces playing in the battle against ISIS?
Senator, if you don't mind, first, we do actually have 3,100 or about 3,000 in Iraq now. About 2,400 of those are U.S. Army soldiers, and they are there now. Their role in Iraq right now is to train and advise Iraqi security forces, provide them the expertise and necessary competence in order to take the fight to ISIS. We are doing that on several fronts in Baghdad, up in Erbil with the Peshmerga, and out west in Al-Assad Air Base.
What can you tell us as the progress that you feel, if there is progress, on training a lot of these troops who we saw cut and ran on the battlefield just a few months ago?
Yeah, so what I would say, Senator, is my opinion is that the reason we saw them cut and run a year ago or 10 months ago, it has more to do with leadership than it has to do with training. I believe that the leaders that had been replaced were ineffective and inefficient, and I think that drove the young men and women to decide not to fight. I also think a lack of confidence in their own government caused that. So part of the important part of this strategy is rebuilding the confidence in the government and also us rebuilding the confidence of their soldiers in order to fight as we move forward.
Will that be tested soon on the battlefield there?
It has begun to be tested. Uh-huh. We've seen some success as we've operated out west, and we'll continue to see it tested on the battlefield.
General, I'm going to shift to another area, cybersecurity, which we've talked about before. Secretary Carter's testimony during his confirmation hearing last month, he affirmed that a cyber equivalent of Pearl Harbor is a threat that we face, for which as a nation we're basically unprepared. I find that possibility to be disconcerting and worrisome. I'm sure you do as well. I think we all agree that it's essential that we protect our nation against cybersecurity attacks. I understand that the President's budget request increases cybersecurity, or would increase it, funding to $5.5 billion. Could you discuss just for a few minutes here the greatest cybersecurity threat to the U.S. stems from where, and what can we do about to combat this?
I believe that we're seeing the development not only in certain nation states, Russia, China, Iran, but also in non-nation states, the ability to potentially conduct attacks on the United States. And I think it's important for us to understand that in some ways, that's a very inexpensive way to try to disrupt the United States. And I think it's something that we have to be very, very aware of, and it can be done on several fronts, whether it is attacking our governmental structure, our military structure, or it could be attacking our civilian infrastructure. And for me, I think it's something that is very, very important, and we are investing in that quite heavily right now.
It's essential for our future security, isn't
it? It is. It's absolutely essential part of our national security.
General, I want to get in a few minutes I have here, the space and missile defense. I was pleased to see this year that the President's budget request, and we know it's just a request, $8.1 billion for the Missile Defense Agency, which is an 8% increase over last year's budget request. Could you discuss just for a minute or two the importance of adequately defending of adequately funding missile defense and how important it is for national security?
We're seeing a growing proliferation of ballistic missile capability, whether it be the testing we see in North Korea, whether we see, in fact, that the Russians seem to be reinvesting in their nuclear program as well. I think it's important for us to have the ability to protect our nation from these threats. It's important that we come up with not only ensure that we have high readiness to all our ballistic missile forces, but that we continue to look at more efficient and effective ways for us to protect our nation and our forces that are forward deployed. Mm-hmm. I would be remiss if I didn't talk about the ballistic missile threat that is faced by our soldiers that are operating in the Middle East as well. And so we have a large portion of the Army ballistic missile force deployed around the world, not only to protect our homeland, but also to protect our soldiers and citizens that are operating, as well as our allies around the world.
Thank you, Senator. Senator from Vermont, Mr. Leahy.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And again, I think all Americans, and I just read more breaking news on the helicopter crash and recovery of bodies. It's I can only imagine how awful both of you gentlemen must feel and your colleagues, because you got the news first. And again, our thoughts and prayers go to the families of soldiers and Marines who were involved. And I would hope, and maybe just ask as a general question, we always see news when a helicopter goes down. It is one thing if it goes down in a combat area and is shot down. They go down in training. Is this something that is constantly reviewed by the Department of Defense, both the training and the readiness and maintenance of these helicopters?
Senator, absolutely. We review this constantly. We have monthly reviews of readiness. We also have we have a safety organization specifically responsible for understanding safety throughout the Army, but it spends a lot of its time specifically on aviation safety and rotary wing safety. And so we spend a lot of time and effort on this, making sure that we look at it thoroughly across the total force and that we pass lessons learned as we see mishaps occur throughout the force.
I mean, we all know that the training is necessary, and the training is often going to be under less than ideal weather conditions, because when you're training for combat and you don't know what the weather condition is going to be, and we understand that. And I have great confidence in both of you in maintaining the readiness and the review. And once a review has been done like this, I'd be pleased to have your staff let me know just what happened. Probably going to be parochial a bit. The Vermont National Guard's 86th Infantry Brigade Combat Team was the only National Guard Brigade to attend the Joint Readiness Training Center last year. They're spending this year ready to deploy if called upon. It's the first brigade to go through this fourth generation cycle without then deploying to Iraq or to Afghanistan. Are there additional resources, experiences that can help keep readiness level up in guard brigades in their on year when they're not deploying?
So we have actually, over the last several years, our percentage of the budget that we're spending on the guard has gone up, and it's because we understand that we have a challenge in sustaining the readiness level. So what we're trying to do is we have a cycle, a sustainable readiness cycle that we're in the process of developing that will help us to sustain a higher level, or at least try to sustain an appropriate level of readiness in the Guard. But there are challenges. I would not be honest with you if I didn't tell you there are challenges with that because of the budget that we have, because we relied a lot on our OCO budget to sustain a higher level of readiness in our Guard. So what we're trying to do is take portions of the Guard and invest in them, and then we adjust it year to year. So, for example, as you mentioned, this year we gave more money to the Vermont National Guard, the 86, to prepare for their rotation and then go to the rotation. Now they are available if we need them. So if we have something that comes up, we will now use them over the next year or two, and we try to, and we then provide them funds to try to sustain that after they come out of the rotation.
And you were very forthright and candid about these problems. I agree with you on the problems on budget when you and I met privately. I just would like to make sure once we, whether it's the Vermont Guard or any other government, they've gone through that training to get that degree of readiness, that we'd be able to utilize it in other things. None of us is saying let's go to war somewhere so we can utilize it, but that they'd be utilized in areas where they could be helpful to you and the Army. I don't think Americans have an interest in becoming involved in another long war like Iraq or Afghanistan or Vietnam. But if assumptions about the duration of future conflict are again wrong, what additional risk would a total army of 980,000 soldiers incur, and what strain would they have with a reserve of just about a 500,000 soldiers?
Yeah, what a lot of people don't, if I could just center comment on, you know, at the height of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, we had over 200,000 National Guard and reservists on full-time active duty. And so, you know, although the active duty was 507, we actually had almost 775,000 actually full-time active duty in order to meet the requirements. So the assumptions that we've made are that our wars will be short duration and we will not conduct phase four operations, which is a follow-up to any wartime. And I believe the risk is there, is that if the assumption is about 6 months to a year, and frankly, if we get into a conflict, they last longer than that. And so that will put a significant strain on our military, a significant strain on our reserve and National Guard forces, because they provide the depth in order for us to sustain this over the long period of time. And I believe that we will be challenged to meet that at a 980 KN strength, if those assumptions are wrong.
The time is
there, Mr. Chairman, and I questioned it. I'll submit to the record for the Secretary on Apache helicopters. I would like an answer on that.
Without objection, the request is granted. Senator from Kansas, Mr. Moran.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. Mr. Secretary General, thank you for joining us. Mr. Secretary, I appreciate your comments in regard to sequestration, the Budget Control Act. I didn't vote for the Budget Control Act for a number of reasons. Two primarily of importance today is a belief that across-the-board cuts don't establish priorities. It suggests that every program has equal value, and that therefore they all should be treated the same. And in my view, we should spend more money on some things, spend less money on some things, perhaps spend no money on others. And to defer to a cross-the-board cut, in my view, demonstrates an irresponsibility on our part. Secondly, I think the primary function, responsibility of the federal government is to defend our nation. And defense cuts, while it was described as half the cuts coming from defense and half the cuts coming from domestic spending, the outcome is something significantly different than that. And I continue to pledge my efforts to work with my colleagues, many of them in this room today, as we try to find a solution. You indicate that words are no longer sufficient, so I'm sorry that mine are just words at the moment, but I can tell you, Mr. Secretary, that many of us are actively pursuing a legislative fix to the issue of sequestration in the Budget Control Act, and I hope that we are successful for the sake of the defense of our nation. I'm sorry that you have the difficult responsibilities the two of you have should we fail in that regard, but we want to give you the flexibility to make decisions that are based upon the best interests of defending our country. So thank you in that regard for your service, and we look forward to working with you. Mr. Secretary, I've asked for an appointment to see you. I hope that at some point in time we can accomplish that. And I'm a new member to this subcommittee, and I'd like to utilize your expertise to find out how I can do my job well, and based upon your experiences in the House and now as the Secretary.
Well, I absolutely commit to that meeting. I wasn't aware of that, but I look forward to it at your convenience, and thank you for your vote. Some of that old House of Representative wisdom, no doubt.
When I was in the House, I despised the Senate. When I'm in the Senate, you despise the House. We ought to find the best of both bodies.
And some despise, no, I won't say that.
I'm not sure I need your advice, Mr. Secretary. You wouldn't be surprised for me to highlight a topic of Fort Riley, Kansas, in our conversation this morning. Fort Riley is the home of the Army's 1st Infantry Division, known as the Big Red One, centered between Junction City and Manhattan, Kansas. We had a recent visit by a Brigadier General, General Cloutier, part of the listening tour across the country. I thought that the General was very observant and very appropriate in the way he conducted himself in listening to Kansans, as well as viewing the great attributes that Fort Riley offers the Army and the country. A couple of things that were said that day that I want to highlight to you, that Fort Riley is often overlooked at the Pentagon. Not everyone has served there, and that it has great qualities that sometimes are not known by those here in Washington, D.C. One of the things that's happened just yesterday that I wanted to highlight for you, Kansas became the first state ever to receive statewide certification of authorization by the FAA for statewide use of drones for unmanned aerial vehicles, and highlight to you that there are 4,000 acres of Fort Riley, but 35,000 acres of guard property, both land and air, now available to the Army, in part for purposes of unmanned aerial vehicle training, and again, something that is brand new to the ability to train and utilize that new mechanism by which we can hopefully win many wars without significant loss of life. I was at Fort Riley on Saturday, saw the new Irwin Army Hospital. One of the things that was said at the listening post was how much infrastructure investment has occurred at Fort Riley, $1.8 billion, including a new hospital to open this year of nearly $350 million. Here's the question I want to highlight for you and get your thoughts today, you or General Odierno. How will the future in strength reduction affect the Army's force structure and the total number of brigade combat teams?
If I can start off, that I would just note, Senator, I can't speak for the Pentagon, but Fort Riley is certainly well-known and deeply appreciated in the Army portion of that building. And it is, as it has been, one of our most important facilities. And that really brings us back to the challenge that we're facing. The cuts that we're highlighting here and in our other hearings are not something we chose to do, but it's really an inescapable outcome of the budget realities that we're facing. As to your specific question, we had a height of BCT in the active component about 45 to 47. We're down to 32 with a 450 K force, and the active component will be down to 30. And as I mentioned in my opening statement, should sequestration return in 16, although it's a back of the envelope calculation, we'd be looking at another 6 BCTs, 4 of which are likely to be active. So just the major fighting components that we have, our BCTs, are greatly diminished from recent numbers, and obviously it places significant limits on our capacity to go out and do other things. So I'm going to put in, I know will be a very unpopular comment here, another part of the challenge, and one of the reasons, again, as I mentioned in my opening comments, that we're looking at having to make reductions across the entire structure of the United States Army, every post, camp, and station, should sequestration return, is that we don't have BRAC authority. Now, I went through 3 BRACs when I was a member of the House, and I know how hard they are, and I lost a base, and it was one of the more painful things I've had to deal with in many, many years. But absent the authority to truly take out excess infrastructure, we have to again distribute the cuts and distribute where we're taking forces across the broader range. So it ends up that it actually helps more bases to actually authorize a BRAC than hurt it. Right now, we're paying about $500 million a year, roughly, just to maintain empty infrastructure, unused infrastructure. And that's a half a billion dollars that we'd like to put into training, into readiness, into family programs, into any number of good areas. So that's one of the reasons, at about 20% excess capacity in the Army, just a rough estimate. We think a BRAC would help us to alleviate a significant part of the cuts that we're all looking at, and that understandably the folks at Fort Riley and just about every other post camp and station are understandably concerned about.
The time of the senator has expired. The senator from Hawaii, Mr. Schatz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Ranking Member Durbin. Thank you, Secretary McHugh and General Odierno. I appreciate you being here today. I share the concerns of every member of this committee and certainly the two of you about the effects of sequester on the Army. These arbitrary spending limits will force you to make hard choices, almost impossible choices, about how to invest in the Army's future, assuming risks that would have consequences for our soldiers, their families, and the national security interests. That's why Vice Chairman Durbin and I introduced the Sequestration Relief Act, and I know there are other members working on other legislative solutions, but our bill provides breathing room for both defense and non-defense budgets this year, and I hope my colleagues will embrace common sense alternatives. We've got to repeal sequester. General Odierno, I'd like to discuss with you the Army SPIA and the potential consequences for soldiers and civilians at Schofield Barracks and at Fort Shafter in Hawaii. And the USARPAC is doing such incredible work in Hawaii and throughout the Asia Pacific region. General Brooks and his excellent leadership throughout the region, but also specifically in PACOM and on the island of Oahu, he's been doing excellent work in positioning Hawaii as we pivot and rebalance to the Asia Pacific region. So my first question for you, General, is do you believe it is the right strategic choice to cut soldiers from Hawaii given our priority on the Asia Pacific rebalance?
Thank you, Senator. I think, as you might know, I was just there. I visited recently. And so for us, it's important because of distance and having them available there in Hawaii, that they are prepared to conduct operations in the Pacific. And so they're very valuable for us, both U.S. Army Pacific. We've actually invested a new 4-star position there, as you mentioned, and our 4 deployed combat teams, as well as our sustainment and other capabilities that are critical to the region. So for us, they are an important part of the strategy. And so it is a place that we deem to be incredibly important. But as the Secretary said, unfortunately, no matter how important we deem it, that these cuts based on sequestration will touch everywhere, even though they are forces that are so important to our national security. But as I've said publicly, the forces that are in Hawaii are very important to our strategy as we rebalance.
Thank you, General. I want to talk a little bit about the Pacific Pathways Initiative, which is designed to develop relationships and elevate the Army's commitment to the region. And I'm glad to see these efforts are backed up with the Army assigning more soldiers to PACOM. But obviously, cutting soldiers from Schofield and Shafter would walk that back. Could you talk a little bit about the Pacific Pathways Initiative, what you've been able to accomplish, and what sequester how sequester would threaten that progress?
So the important part for us is that what many people don't realize is that 8 out of the 10 largest land armies in the world are in the Pacific. The majority of the influential services in each one of the nations in the Pacific are actually Army forces. So what Pacific Pathways has allowed us to do is engage in a much more systematic and capable way with our force. For example, we did an exercise this year where we had units deployed to Indonesia, Malaysia, and Japan to do joint training with those forces. That enables us to build partnerships, to build relationships, and to gain access to very important parts of the Pacific region as we look to execute our national security and regional security issues. It'll open door, it's starting to open doors for us in places like Vietnam and other places as well. So for us, it's essential to our strategy of the future. If sequestration occurs, it's going to do two things. First, it'll make it more difficult for us to fund exercises and training exercises like Pacific Pathways, and it could reduce the volume of capability that we have in order to conduct exercises and reach out to these very important countries as we try to develop mutual understanding and security relationships across the Pacific.
And just a final question. I have just about 40 seconds left. Could you talk about the signals that might be sent under the sequester in terms of whether or not both our friends and our allies believe that we're really committed to the Asia-Pacific rebalance in the case that we have to pare back our presence in the Pacific?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, our ability to deter and compel are very important aspects of what we do. I think Admiral Locklear, the PACOM commander, is very, very succinct when he talks about this. Our job in the military is to prevent war. And our job is to shape the environment that makes it a better place for our country. And I believe the potential, if we have to reduce our capacity and capabilities there, affects that, our ability to shape a very important region for us, which is the Pacific region.
Thank you, General. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Senator. The time of the senator has expired. The senator from Missouri, Mr. Blunt.
Thank you, Chairman. I wouldn't want to be the only person on the panel that didn't mention bases in our state. I know you've both visited Fort Leonard Wood within the last year or so, and I'd suggest again that's one of the locations we have, and there are a few others, but there's no energy problem, there's no water availability problem, there's no environmental problem, there's no encroachment problem. We did have a hearing, as Senator Moran mentioned, that they had of the SPEA group. The governor was there. I was there. Senator McCaskill, who serves on the Armed Services Committee, was there. Congresswoman Hartzler, who serves on Armed Services in the House, was there. In addition, there were 2,000 people at Nutter Field House, and they had an overflow facility that they put people in who could listen to that hearing. You've both been there. You know the incredible community support for that facility, and I'm not sure there's a turnout that compares to that. I was told by the person who conducted the that session that there had been 11,000 emails regarding these various sessions, and over 4,000 of them came from the Fort Leonard Wood community, and having been there, you wouldn't be surprised by that. General, there's one question I do have that relates specifically to the fort. I don't think we've told you that question was coming, so you may want to take it for the record. But the Surgeon General last year, when I was serving on the Armed Services Committee, said that the number one medical priority for the military was on MILCON was the hospital at Fort Leonard Wood. It then went off the FIDEP for 15. It's not on the FIDEP for 16. Serves that facility, also serves quite a bit of the community. Last upgrade there was about 40 years ago. At least a year ago, the Surgeon General for the Army was still saying this was the number one priority for medical facilities. And if you want to respond to that.
I would just say it remains very high on our priority list. The bottom line is our MILCON budget, because of the reduced dollars, we had to take risk. And so that's one of the areas we have taken risk. And it is still a priority for us to get an upgraded medical facility at Fort Leonard Wood. The problem is we simply don't have the dollars to do that right now. And we understand the fact that it is in great need. And so as the Surgeon General has stated, it's clearly her top priority. And so as we go forward, we had to choose where we took risk, and that was one of the places we decided to take risk. And it's not a good area. It's one of those very difficult decisions we have to make. I don't know.
It was precisely that, as the Chief said, Senator, a MILCON, MedCom, MILCON cut that caused us to have to realign not just that facility, but a number of others. It's not a place that we particularly enjoy taking risks for obvious reasons, but if you talk to some of your colleagues, we have other hospital projects that have been similarly delayed that we want to get to as soon as we can. But as I know you understand, it's a product of money available.
Right. While talking about medical, I will say something I know both of you are supportive of, and I've been really active of at that same at that same hearing. I asked the Surgeon General of the Army, said based on the NIH view that one out of four adult Americans has a mental health issue, diagnosable and almost always treatable, would that be different in the military? And her answer was no. She said, we recruit from the general population. We don't have any reason to believe that that same impact is not in the military. And whatever we can do to continue to move as we are moving mental health into the area of all other physical health, so it's treated the same way, expensed the same way, available to dependents and retirees the same way, and I know you're both supportive of that.
We are dedicating significant resources, particularly in hiring behavioral health specialists. When I first came to this job nearly 6 years ago, our stated requirement for those professionals was about 2,300. It's now over 5,500. We're about 85% of that fill. The reason for that growth is that we have begun to recognize, as we should, that the need for these kinds of providers is absolutely essential. So we've embedded behavioral health specialists at the brigade level. We've tried to get the care delivery system further disposed out through our ranks. And I would say as well, another part of it is the destigmatizing the reaching out for help.
Right.
There's a certain attitude in the military that you just pull yourself up by your bootstraps, number one, and number two, that if you do get help, somehow that'll hurt your career. We have worked hard to make it easier for soldiers to reach out for mental health care. And if you look at the number of help-seeking activities that have occurred, they have grown astronomically, as they should. That's what we want. I think we're getting there, but it's been a long fight, and it'll be a long fight yet to go, given, as the Surgeon General and you noted in your data, the very widespread nature of these challenges.
If I could just add,
the chair has to advise the senator that his time has expired. The senator from Washington, Ms. Murray.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary General, it's good to see you here. Thank you for being here. General, during the brigade combat team realignment a few years ago, the Army cut units from bases across the country. And if the Army is forced into further reductions, I want to be sure that it will be a well-balanced, strategy-based approach. The units and bases in my home state of Washington are really critical to our national security strategy, including the rebalance to Asia and the threat of instability on the Korean Peninsula. We need more investments in Washington State, certainly not more cuts, and I just wanted to say I really hope that you will really protect those critical assets.
Ma'am, as Senator, as we move forward, we'll take into consider not only strategy, we'll take and consider the mix of heavy, striker, light. We've got to make sure we sustain the right mix of capabilities, and that's part of the assessment that we'll do. And it will be based on strategy and need, and that will be the underlying, the most important factor as we look at where we need to go.
Okay. And I also wanted to thank you for your focus on helping soldiers transition successfully when they leave the Army. And I especially want to thank you for standing up the Soldier for Life office and all the focus you've brought to improving the transition programming. If the Army is forced to make serious cuts to force structure under sequestration, I wanted to ask you, how will the Army make sure those critical transition programs have the resources to support the number of soldiers that will be separated?
There's two things that we've learned. First, we are absolutely dedicated to this because, as you mentioned, the Soldier for Life program is we want those who leave to understand that they gained from being in the Army, and that helps us in the long run. Secondly, it's a combination of our resources and using the private sector resources that are out there. What we have found is there's so many organizations that want to work with us to hire. We've had some great programs, as you know, out of Fort Lewis that have helped us to do this. So we want to invest in where we use our resources to help us find the private resources that can help us the transition. So you have my word that we will continue to dedicate ourselves to that as we transition soldiers.
Okay, I think that everybody wants to participate in that. We want to make sure that that's ongoing. And finally, I know you absolutely share my view that soldiers deploying in harm's way should have what they need to get their jobs done safely and effectively. My office has been working with the Army for the last several months to speed the consideration of an operational needs statement for a unit from Joint Base Lewis-McChord. I understand the need to carefully consider these requests, but this unit is already deployed, and we're told this process is still going to take a few more months, and I'm concerned how long this is taking. I really believe General, that this issue needs your personal attention. Can you give me your commitment on that?
Yeah, it's been approved.
It's been approved. When will they be notified?
They should have been notified already in the last couple of days.
Okay, I appreciate
this. This process we've been working through. It was first of all, we have to get. It's a process that took a little bit too long, but it has been approved.
Okay, thank you very much. I appreciate that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator. The senator from South Carolina.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both. We have Army bases, Fort Jackson in South Carolina, and we're very proud of the what Fort Jackson does for the Army. So rather than asking you about Fort Jackson, I think, Mr. Secretary, you expressed very well that if the Army continues to have to implement sequestration numbers, the Army is going to be much smaller. And if you don't have a BRAC, we're really putting the Army in a bad spot.
Certainly a much more difficult spot.
Well, so at the end of the day, as much as we all love our bases, we're going to have to address this problem. And if we want to insist upon sequestration, then we better be willing to go back home and tell people, you can't get there from here, and every base that's open today is not going to survive. Does that make sense?
It does.
Okay, General O, how many years have you been deployed since 9/11?
Approximately 6 years, sir.
Your son lost his arm, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
You're a pretty typical military family in that regard, aren't you?
Yes, sir.
You're a four-star general, but there are other people under your command who've been deployed for 6 years or longer, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And they've lost friends and been injured themselves. Would you say this has been a long war?
Yes, sir.
Do you think the war is remotely over?
No, sir.
If we are smart, once we clear ISIL out of Iraq, if we can ever do that and not give the place to Iran, would you recommend a residual force to maintain the gains we've...
I think one of the things that we have not done a very good job with is consolidating our gains.
Yeah.
And I think it's important
well,
that we
General,
come up with the ways
this
to
is
that.
An important moment because we got to figure out what kind of military needs we're going to have. So from a commander's point of view, it'd be very wise to leave a residual force behind this time so the same thing doesn't happen again.
I would say we should take it into real consideration. I think
right.
It does make a difference.
Do you agree that if you don't leave any American forces behind, it's likely to happen again?
I think what it does, it keeps us engaged and reduces the possibility of it happening.
Yeah, and that makes us safer.
It does.
We're at risk by ISIL, right? ISIL is just not a regional problem. It's a threat to the homeland.
It is growing. It is growing across the region. I think over time, it's going to become a threat regionally and internationally.
Gotcha. Would you recommend that we look at our force structure in Afghanistan based on conditions, not just an arbitrary date?
I always believe we should do a conditions-based strategy.
If we can find a force to go in and destroy ISIL in Syria, if we can ever find one, would we be smart to make sure Syria doesn't go bad again?
That would be in our best interest, Senator.
Okay. Would you agree with me, when you look down the road, the Army is going to be fighting terrorism over there for a long time to come, if we're smart?
I think we're going to be fighting terrorism, and I also think there'll be some other regional instability that we're going to have to deal with.
Okay, so is this a generational struggle?
I think it's, yes, I do. I absolutely agree with that.
So from a planning point of view, the likelihood of us being deployed forward to deal with what is a growing threat is high. And there are other problems just beyond terrorist organizations, is that correct?
That's correct, sir.
We want to have a deterrent effect against rogue nations.
That's correct.
If that's the case, then
why would we even consider going down the sequestration road? Can you give me a good reason why we would do that?
No, I cannot. And in fact, if I could just make a quick comment on what you just said. One of the things that we're really having a problem with, as you bring combatant commanders in to testify, they're going to tell you that they need more forward station capability.
Which protects us.
Which protects us. And the problem we have is as we reduce our force structure, it makes it more and more difficult for us to provide forward station forces, which puts us more at risk. And that's one of the problems we're having.
Obviously, it makes it more difficult to modernize.
Right.
Are you looking for a fair fight in the future with the enemy?
No, sir.
I'm looking for an overwhelmed, decisive advantage over the enemy. And that will be lost if we don't modernize our forces, because wars change. In terms of morale, how is morale given the uncertain nature of the budget?
So for the Army, I would say as I go around and I see our soldiers and they're preparing, they inspire me, they continue to do what they're asked of. That said, there's a lot of pressure on our soldiers right now, especially in the Army, because of the massive reductions that we've already gone through and the massive reductions that we're facing. There's uncertainty. And then on top of that, there's lots of discussion about paying benefits. There's lots of discussion about retirement. There's lots of discussion about other things. And all of this is putting pressure on them and their families. And so although we have not seen the breaking point yet, I worry when that will occur in the future.
One quick question. I know my time is up.
The time has expired.
Could I have just 30 seconds?
Senator from South Carolina.
Thank you. Great Britain is having an argument among itself about how much to spend on their forces. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Is it a fair statement the free world is reducing its military capability across the board as radical Islam and rogue nations increase their capability?
My assessment is the majority of our allies are in the process of reducing their capabilities today at a significant rate.
The senator from Alaska, Ms. Murkowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, General Secretary. Welcome. Thank you for all that you do, your leadership. I want to move from questions about the hot spots to colder places and hopefully keeping colder places from becoming hot spots. Last week, in testimony before the Senate Armed Services Committee, Chairman Dempsey made mention that the Russians are standing up 6 new brigades, 4 of them to be placed in the Arctic. The Secretary followed up that the Russians are in fact very active in the Arctic. And that prompted a letter to both of you from the full Alaska delegation suggesting that instead of drawing down the Army presence in Alaska, which was the subject of the listening sessions up there last week, that perhaps the Army should be doing exactly the opposite, in fact, growing its presence in Alaska. So to you, General, can you expand on the statement that the chairman made last week and the secretary about Russian activity in the Arctic? What is Mr. Putin up to here?
So we have seen over the last several years a obviously increased interest in the Russians in the Arctic. There are clear indications, as the chairman mentioned, that they are increasing their presence and building bases, so in the future they will be able to increase their presence and have an impact in the Arctic region. And it's one that clearly has gotten our attention.
And given that it has gotten your attention, what are you doing to adjust your plans within Army going forward?
So first off, what I'm waiting for is we need a strategy of how we're going to deal with the Arctic from NORTHCOM, who's responsible for that. And as they develop that strategy, we will then work to see what our contributions are to that strategy. I have talked to the command of Army Alaska, who has some thoughts on this. And so we have taken that from him, and we are looking at that internally to the Army now to see what that means to us in the future. So we are taking a look at that. But we have to rely on NORTHCOM in order to develop a strategy that would allow us then to decide, to understand what our commitments need to be.
We've had discussion over the past several years talking about whether it's prudent to reduce Army's presence given the pivot to the Pacific, the realignment there. And you responded, you've responded several times, that the Army didn't view it as prudent to reduce its presence in the Pacific because Alaska sits at the top of the Pacific there. So I'm taking from your conversation, our conversation here this morning, that you would agree that it is not wise for a kind of change in view or change in perspective as it relates to the Pacific and Alaska's role.
Senator, I have not. I believe it's an important piece of what we do in the Pacific. That's the problem we have now. There is lots of areas I could make that same comment, and that's the problem. We now have to make difficult decisions that impacts our security, and that's somewhat distressing, frankly.
Distressing for all of us. I understand that you were back home in Alaska, my home in Alaska, in February to observe our U.S. Army Alaska troops in training. You got to go out to Black Rapids. I think that they treated you well. I'm told that the weather was about 40 below zero, which is a good sense of what it means to be Army strong, Army Arctic tough, because it really does develop a toughness out there. But in terms of our preparation as an Army in dealing with interests in high altitudes and cold places, you've got some pretty exceptional training grounds right there. But I think we also need to recognize that perhaps we have some of the requirements, the assets that are perhaps not sufficient or not ready for Arctic climbs, specifically the SUSVI. Can you speak very quickly to the Arctic focus here?
Yeah, so first off, the ability to conduct the training and the necessity for us to be able to have that capability is important. And so I would say, first of all, the overall training is unmatched anywhere. I also believe we can actually use it for other things beyond just Arctic training. I think the capability of the training areas up there can help the Army in many different environments because of the terrain, because of the elevation, and because of others. So I think it has broader application as well, and I've asked us to take a look at the broader application as well of how we can use that. In terms of SUSVI, it is problematic. It is a program, as you know, we have not invested in, we're maintaining what we have. We have not invested in any improvements. And I think that's something that as we look to the future, we have to take a look at how we want to operate in a very cold weather environment, what our capabilities are. The problem we have is we simply don't have the budget right now and the modernization capability to do it as it falls on our current priority list. It's not, that does not mean we don't think it's essential or important. It's just not high enough right now for us to invest in that.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Shelby has
Thank you.
Asked for recognition.
Thank you. Secretary McHugh, we see from our testimony and our basic knowledge of what's going on in the world, you do and the general does, we've discussed here. As we reduce our forces because of sequestration and other things, and we're living in a dangerous world with a resurgent Russia, a looming threat from China down the road, turmoil in the Middle East, which is probably going to be with us a long time, it just defies logic that we would not fund our military, our Army, our Navy, our Marines, our Air Force, realizing the threat now and the threat in the future to the security of this country. And that's been well said. You agree with that?
Absolutely, Senator. Mm-hmm. I want to acknowledge, however, the challenge that lies before all of you. And if sequestration were easy to fix, I believe in all my heart you would have fixed it already. The political challenge, small p, of getting 435 members of the House and 100 members of the Senate to agree, at least a majority of each, on a way forward, and to get it to the President, who hopefully will sign it, is a, I understand, a high mountain. But the challenges that you describe, Senator, and that many of your colleagues have spoken about this day are absolutely real. And again, as the Chief noted in his opening comments, if we go to sequestration and 420,000 in the active component, we cannot meet the defense strategic guidance, which I think is a very dangerous place to put this country.
Do you believe it's incumbent upon you and the general, as well as us, members of the Congress and the president, to tell the American people the truth of the threats in the world over and over, because we can't fund defense on the cheap and expect to be the number one military power in the world and protect our interest in the world as I see it? You disagree?
I fully agree with what you say, and that's why we appreciate opportunities such as this.
Absolutely.
Because it gives us the very important chance to, through your questions, to put a fine point on exactly the risks that we'll be taking and to better describe, because most Americans in their lives, thankfully, have other things that gain their attention rather than the threats that all of you deal with, and obviously we're dealing with as well. We need to help them get a better picture of that.
Secretary McHugh, moving into some specifics here, reports indicate that China completed a third flight test of its hypersonic weapon in December of last year. Shouldn't we complete a third flight test of our own supersonic weapon? And what do you expect to be the timeline, if there is one, and I hope it would be, for operational deployment of the advanced hypersonic weapon should the need arise? And how important, ultimately, is the advanced hypersonic weapon to deterring this hypersonic weapons threat from hostile nations or would-be hostile nations like China, Russia, and where else?
Well, as you noted very accurately, Senator, our potential adversaries continue to show great interest in and develop hyper technology. We believe that we have to advance a similar effort. As I know you're aware, the Army did a test, and I believe it was 14, to test the current level of technology on our hypersonic weapon platforms. That was successful. We did have some launch problems and a scheduled follow-up test. My understanding is now the Defense Department has scheduled a Navy-led test. I believe it's in fiscal year 17. Mm-hmm. And as it is with all things, particularly in these kinds of high-tech, S&T-centric developments, funding is absolutely essential.
I'm going to shift to another area, to Fort Rucker, Alabama. It's my understanding that the Army has conducted or is conducting a feasibility analysis of moving two warrant officer courses from Fort Rucker to Fort Leavenworth. It's according to the data, and I don't have all the data, that I've received, there would be no savings there. Do you want to speak to that, or can you furnish the committee the analysis you're coming up with, where we can look at that?
Well, we can certainly do both. You're correct. We are conducting a cost-benefit analysis of our warrant officer training program writ large. Part of that would be the efforts and the training aspects that you mentioned. That CBA has not yet been finished. I believe we have, through letters, made a commitment to you to come and to brief you on the results of that analysis. But the entire initiative is progressing. I don't want to mislead you or other members of the committee, but we have not yet completed the study that you mentioned.
You mentioned some excess capacity, you know, earlier in our forces, in our thing, and probably a need down the road for BRAC, which none of us particularly like, but often fear.
I understand.
But I was thinking about Fort Rucker is the helicopter training, basic training for the Army and the Air Force, and so many other things. But it's not the basic training for the Navy and the Marines. We've been down that road before. But haven't there been some studies that would show great savings if we did that, if we did the basic training at Fort Rucker of all the military? I'm not talking about specific after the Marines need specific missions and the Navy has. I'm talking about the basics. You want to address that or you want General to get?
Well, I'll defer to General Odierno. Of course, that would be a Defense Department level decision.
There'd be some inter-service rivalry there. I understand that. And we probably can't solve it here today, but it's something, if we're starting to say we need to save money, we do, and we got to have money to have the number one security forces in the world. We got to look everywhere, but go ahead.
Senator, I'm not aware of a study we've done on this, but certainly something we can take a look at, and I think it's worth taking a look at, working with the other services. If I could just comment on the warrant officer, I am not happy with our warrant officer training. I just want to make sure you understand, and it's nothing to do with Fort Rucker, it's just in very general terms. I believe we have to do much better in training our new warrant officers and our senior warrant officers, and we are in the process of revamping this program. So it is a combination of cost-benefit analysis as well as providing a place where we can do the right training with the right access to our educational institutions. So we owe you an answer on that.
Sure.
But it's something that's very important to me, sir.
Well, it's very important to have the best training. It's also to have the best savings, both, right? Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator. Senator from Missouri?
From Kansas, Mr. Chairman.
Kansas,
thank you very much.
Although
I would follow up on the comments from the Senator from Missouri, the listening tour that involved General Cloutier in Kansas was very well received. The general indicated that the Army knew the square footage of Fort Riley, knew he had all the facts and figures, but came to see whether there was to learn about the heart of Fort Riley. And 4,300 Kansans showed up at Fort Riley at Junction City, Kansas, to demonstrate their love and care, compassion for the soldiers who serve at Fort Riley, who are deployed from Fort Riley, and their families. I wanted to compliment the Army. I was, as I said earlier, at Irwin Army Hospital on Saturday last, and a major improvement in the facilities, a great opportunity for us to care for soldiers and their families. We understand that we are one of a few who have that new facility in the works, and we appreciate the Army's decision to proceed with that hospital. I also want to ask a couple of questions, perhaps for the record, but I wanted to ask you, General, the division headquarters from Fort Riley is now in Iraq. General Funk is leading our operations in Iraq. We are expecting his return to Kansas, to Fort Riley, later this year. We would welcome you both to be there to welcome General Funk and his mission, the division headquarters, home. What do you see happening next in Iraq and the war on ISIL?
Well, I mean, so this is something we see going on for some time. The 1st Infantry Division will be replaced by another headquarters that will go in and do that. We have not yet announced that, but we will soon. And so I can see this continuing for some time. President has said 3 years. I would say it'll be that minimally, and we'll have to look to see. We'll go back to the President if we need longer than that. But I see this going on for some time. The other comment I would make, by the way, and you mentioned UAVs earlier, you know, we just made the first deployment of our Gray Eagle UAV that came out of the 1st Infantry Division, and they are now in Kuwait, and they will stand up and really conduct the first combat operations of our Gray Eagle capability under division control. That's a very important step for us in our investment. And it goes back to the comments you made, the ability to train with that at home station is very valuable to us. It's going to be an integral part of our ability to conduct future warfare. So I think this is a very important milestone for us as they are now deployed in Kuwait and to support this operation.
General, thank you for saying that. I wasn't very articulate in my comments, but the point I was attempting to make was that while there's 4,000 acres at Fort Riley, there's another 35,000 acres at Great Plains Training Center, located near Salina, home of Kansas State University Salina. And Kansas State University has received the certificate of authorization from the FAA this week for the use of unmanned systems statewide. And that we see in Kansas as a significant development, not only militarily but commercially. It's a significant development. Let me ask the Secretary in the time that I have left, and Mr. Secretary, perhaps these are questions for the record, but for each of the seven division-level Army posts, could you tell me, give me a cost comparison on the following factors and describe how they might inform stationing recommendations and decisions? BCTs to sustain a division headquarters and a two-brigade combat team set to be housed and maintained readiness level as part of the Army Force generational model. Environmental, what are the installation environmental management costs? What are the operations and maintenance costs? And what's the population density, and how does the Army consider potential impact on future growth when making stationing decisions? So I'm looking for the comparison in costs among those seven installations.
We have 10, don't we? 10 divisions?
Mr. Secretary, if it'd be helpful, I'll just submit that question to you in writing.
Yeah, I wished I had the command of knowledge that very insightful question requires, but I don't.
I wish I had your political skill in responding.
I have a lot of different ways to say I don't know, but we'll certainly do our best to get that information to you.
Thank you very much, and I look forward for us having a meeting sometime.
I do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, General.
If there are no other questions for the panel, we want to express our appreciation for your cooperation, your attendance here today, and your willingness to respond to our questions. We thank you for not only your testimony, but your distinguished service to our nation as the leaders and commanders of our armed forces. We're very grateful for your distinguished service, and we look forward to a continuing dialogue throughout the fiscal year 2016 appropriations process. Senators may submit additional written questions, and we would request that you respond to those when we submit them. The Defense Subcommittee is going to reconvene on Wednesday, March 18 at 10:30 a.m. to receive testimony from the Missile Defense Agency. Until then, the Subcommittee will stand in recess.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.